大家好，欢迎来到今天的神秘2020。那开始讲者的活动前，大会先宣导一些防疫守则以及一些那个行为准则。第一个是行为准则 COC。活动，这边请大家如果有小猫袋或者是黑色手提袋的话，拿出里面的一张行为准则跟我一起宣导。本活动致力于提供一个无骚扰的环境给每一位参与者，无论其性别、年龄、性倾向、残疾、外貌、种族或信仰，我们绝对不能容忍任何人对会议参与者以任何形式的骚扰。在本会议中使用含有性的意向及语言是不恰当的，包含会议相关活动及线上社交网络出于教育目的的议程内容则不在此限，参与者若违反此规将受到制裁或被驱离会议并不予以退款，处置活动由活动总召裁定。那通报方式的话，如果有遇到这些行为准违反行为准则的骚扰事件，当事人或目击者可以透过以下两种方式通报。第一个就是到绿色魔法学校大门口的咨询处寻求负责人的协助。第二个是可以扫 QR code 二维码填写线上通报表单。那接下来宣导一下防疫守则。
应该是听得见吗？我听不见。还是说他妈没有？
在会场内呢，请全程佩戴口罩。各一层采管制人数，请遵循工作人员指示。若已达人数上限，请勿进入。在会议场内若感到身体不适，请确认完自身防疫措施，并联络会场工作人员。有身体不适者或居家隔离、居家检疫、自主健康管理等具感染风险情形，请在家里休息。那接下来宣导一下场地规范。本馆 C Hub 呢 ，EF、3F 都可以饮食，那请注意清洁。饮食时请保持社交距离。除了 C1、C3 外，其他空间不开放，请注意大会参与者以外其他人的权益。那接下来特别感谢今年的居民神秘的合作伙伴，那特别感谢FNF 基金会自由民主党是大会的合办单位。那接下来跟大家提示一下，我们每一场议程都有 HackMD 共笔网页，可以让所有会众把想写的心得都写在上面跟大家交流。那另外我们每一场议程也都有线上提问区，如果你害羞不敢现场举手问的话，或者是讲者在线上你不容易跟他沟通的话，欢迎在上面留下你的问题。那操作的方式就是，第一个先到我们的议程网页右上角有一个笔，点下去你可以到共笔的网页，那欢迎在里面大家帮忙共笔议程内容。那接下来在共笔的绿色框框里面可以找到线上提问的连结，按下去你就可以随意向讲者发问。那如果听不懂讲者在讲什么的，可以就是找到昨天大会记的行前通知，里面有口译的 Webex 连结，那可以按照信件内容操作就可以到英华口译，也请记得戴耳机跟用 slide 问哦。好，然后呢特别工商一下我们的议程，大家的提袋里面有一张 conference 的报名，那无论是短讲、动手做、带讨论、周日下午的开放工作，如果你是会众，想要分享自己的 idea， 想要发表，想找人一起讨论，就可以来报名这个 conference。那如果你想听到其他人分享他们的 idea， 就投票给他们，在 conference 时段可以直接过去参与。如果然后要投票的话，在那个提袋里面有贴纸。都可以，就是去投票那个 conference 墙贴上，如果掉了的话，就可以到报名处再拿一次。那线上会众也可以参与，有兴趣线上参与或提案的话， 到 HackMB 大会共笔的目录找开放工作坊 on conference， 进去就会看到线上参与的办法了。然后还有接下来是我们的闪电 talk 的名额，那有想要说的话可以来这里报名，在大会最后一天现场报名散台，每场限时五分钟，主题不拘，名额有限，先抢先赢。那超时的话就会关麦。好，那接下来是宣导。接下来就欢迎大家接下来的演讲。
就是可以，大家可以扫描这个 QR code。那如果说对于说现场讲者他们接下来的就是分享有些问题的话，可以透过这个 slide link 去做一个提问的动作，这样子。
稍微再稍等一下，那个讲者已经在线上了。
Hi everyone, I think we are about to get started. Good morning to all of you. It's evening here for me and Lily in Washington, D.C. I'm really delighted to be with you. So, Thanks for coming in early in the morning, your time. I'm going to ask Libby, if she can, to come up with me and turn her video on so that we can all see her. See if that works. And we had a few technical difficulties before we got started here. Okay, while we're waiting, while we're starting to get Libby sort of timed, hi Libby, there she is. First of all, I'm just going to introduce myself. I am Amy Stella. I am the Senior Advisor for Digital Democracy at the International Republican Institute. We work on democracy assistance initiatives worldwide. For me personally, one of the greatest pleasures of my life has been working with the GovHero community on various information integrity efforts around the election and then in the aftermath of the election as well. It's been, you know, just such an incredible thing to see and to be part of such a collaborative open community that I think is really a model for the world. Another thing that really inspires me, person that really inspires me and has been one of the highlights of this terrible year for me has been the opportunity to work with Libby Liu. So I'll just give a brief introduction to her, a brief introduction to the subject, and then I will throw a whole bunch of questions her way. You guys know what you're most interested in, so please also use the various formats, including Slido and elsewhere, to ask questions, and I'll try and track them and field them here. So Libby Liu started out at Radio Free Asia. Well, didn't start out, but worked at Radio Free Asia for a very long time, and in that, as she was sort of running that work there, started to realize that the barriers to internet freedom and the barriers to internet to access for information online were really one of the huge impediments to the work that she was trying to do, which was deliver fact-based information to as many people around the world as possible, and particularly Asia. And so she actually founded the Open Technology Fund. The Open Technology Fund is really the organization that has been behind the support for some of the most important internet freedom technologies that exist today. For those of you who haven't followed the news this year, there's been a little bit of a political debacle in the U.S. around all of this. There's been a lot of political debacles around a lot of different things in the U.S., but of particular concern to those of us who believe that internet freedom is critical to freedom worldwide and liberty worldwide, this has been a real issue. And so that sort of has thrown up this whole set of questions around how we ensure that internet freedom technologies are not completely dependent, or not completely dependent, but aren't so dependent on a single source of funding, on a single source of support. How do we create a community around these technologies and internet? Oh, hi, Kat.
Sorry.
That's wonderful. How do we create an ecosystem that supports all of this? So Libby, my very first question to you, I tried to describe it, but in your own words, what was it that led you to found the Open Technology Fund?
Hi, Amy. Thanks so much for asking, and thank you, everybody, for having me. That's really, really nice. As Amy said, I ran the Radio Free Asia for 16 years, and Radio Free Asia's job is to deliver news and information in societies that have no access to uncensored information. So, by nature, everything we did and everyone who worked on the things we did were always in danger and targeted by the governments, who obviously don't want truth be told, and it just became worse and worse as authoritarians were able to weaponize digital access and digital activity, so that by 2011 it was really obvious that there would be no way that we could do our job and give people the information they need to make informed decisions for their own lives unless we're able to protect them. And when I say protect, I mean not just the journalists, but our sources, the online, the frontline defenders, the people on the ground that are doing human rights work and important work in advocacy on every issue that you can imagine. All these people were being targeted and at risk because of what we were doing. And it was obvious that it was just going to get worse. And since then, it's become much, much worse, and we all unfortunately developed in the way that it, we thought it was going to. So in 2011, I realized that we just could not do it anymore the way we were doing. We had to find a way to protect people. We had to find a way not just protect people giving information, but people using information, because they were targeting our users in all these countries as well. I mean, just to give you an example, in China, ReuseFree Asia was jammed, our reusing bills were jammed, all of our sites were blocked. The initials RFA were so high sensitivity, but I don't know if you remember this, Google moved their servers offshore from China to Hong Kong, and when they turned on their services, the whole thing blocked. It's because in that random code that was their IP address, it contained a sequence of letters, RFA. It's an illustration of how insane all this pressure was on RFA and against RFA, and using digital means just exacerbated the problem. So we wanted to do something different. The good news is the supporters of internet freedom on the Hill in the US Congress, they understood the threat that we were facing and they understood that we had to do something now. But there was no way to perform this because everything in the US government works in a bureaucracy that's purposeful. But technology, especially technology that is directly confronting aggressive and innovative authoritarians, has to be able to be developed and funded at the speed of technology and not the speed of the US government. I mean, for people in the room who are not familiar with the crazy budget cycle of US government, basically agencies are required to guess what they're going to need money for 3 years from now. So every budget cycle is so far removed from the actual threat that people are experiencing on the ground. So it was great. We went up and explained our vision. Our vision was to do this completely differently, do it in a very iterative, collaborative, intentionally, radically transparent, and accountable way that was dynamic. And we wanted anybody with a good idea to be able to apply without having, you know, a giant infrastructure that was creating grant proposals for people and all of this. We wanted people to do what they wanted to do, what they cared about, what their passion was for this really important purpose that ultimately touches anybody who touches the internet. So that's really why we started in 2011, and it's been obviously a huge, huge success with, you know, a huge learning opportunity we had here in fiscal 2020, which is what Amy referred to as the crisis in 2020. But we can talk about that later.
Constructive way of talking about it is our huge. Actually, Libby, maybe you could talk through so that folks can understand a little bit about how what OTF fundamentally produced and why it's been so successful. Could you talk a little bit about some of the projects that you've supported and some of the real successes that you've seen come out?
Well, there are many, but I think that one of the most important things, the reason why the Open Technology Fund is successful is because it is based on a community. And it's built on trust. Every single day, OTF has to demonstrate that we are worthy of people trust in us to provide funding. And also to collaborative funders, you also want to complement our work. They need to be able to trust that we've put everything, we've done the appropriate due diligence, that we can manage the programs, that we actually understand technology. I mean, the idea of a non-subject matter expert making decisions of such importance and vitalness to people around the world is just appalling to me. So, you know, these are some of the great, I think, demonstrable structural successes we had, which, you know, I hope has shown not just our funder, the US government, but other funders, potential funders, that there is a way to do this work in a way that's collaborative and sustainable and constantly growing. So in terms of projects we funded, you're probably most familiar with Signal, the Signal protocol, which is what allows for end-to-end encryption, not just on the Signal messaging app, but you know, behind the technology on so many others, including WhatsApp and Skype and all of these other ways to talk to people digitally. Because we absolutely have to ensure that people are not going to be punished for exercising free speech online. Another hugely successful project that we fund is Tor. Probably in the Gov community, you are very familiar with Tor. We think it's absolutely vital to the entire security and privacy, anonymity, all of the things that we have to do to protect people from being targeted based on their digital lives. We supported CertBot and Let's Encrypt, which has, I think Let's Encrypt has issued something like 200 million certificates so far. We funded a project that allowed easy conversion to the HTTPS for 150 million websites. We invested in the WireGuard protocol, which is, you know, revolutionizing the way VPNs work and has significantly reduced the attack space, the attack surface that authoritarians can look at. But the most important thing that MTF has done is cultivated and nurtured a global community of activists, not just on internet freedom, but the people that need to be protected by internet freedom. So frontline defenders, human rights activists, democracy workers, advocates, and with the developers and the designers and the policymakers all together so that the solutions that are created can be deployed and implemented in a really effective way, but also that it's designed with the user in mind. Because too many times, people who are super, super smart don't understand that, you know, there are people like me who are not super, super smart, and I really need the technology to be dummy-proof. I remember the first couple of years, Dan Meredith Blige said, "We want this thing so easy our boss can use it." That was me. I was your grandma. So those are just a few of the projects that we've done, but we have done rapid response interventions in 60 countries. You know, we work with communities and organizations, NGOs, civil society groups in over 80 countries. The scope and scale of what OTF has become is enormous, because as I said at the beginning, we wanted to create something that was iterative, that would be constantly evolving with the environment, both the adversarial environment, but also this amazing community of people that understand we have to work together. And when we come together, the impact is just enormous. So, I'm sorry. Those are some things that come off the top of my head.
Well, it's wonderful. I've listened to you talk about these projects forever. I mean, there's a few things that I take away from that. A lot of the way that you describe how you formed OTF and the culture of OTF is quite reflective to me of what I heard from GovZero about how they talk about it as well, being open, being collaborative, that everything was built on a foundation of trust. And I think, you know, we've really seen that in the most successful communities that have been built in this space. So that's certainly one of the most incredible things. I think one of the other things that I really take away takeaway from watching us, yeah, over the last couple of years has been the commitment to open source and to the open source movement. And then, as you say, the commitment to UI UX and making sure that everything is user friendly and that security and safety are built into the platforms and products and projects that you support, rather than being things where we have to go into settings, go 10 pages in and click a little box. For us at IRI, you know, I straddle this space that is between technology and democracy assistance. And most of the people that I work with don't understand technology. They might have received a smartphone for the first time in the last couple of years. They're still trying to figure out how to do it. But they're working on LGBTQ issues in incredibly repressive societies in which their government has figured out how to use a smartphone and how to use their smartphone in ways that can reduce their capacity to be change makers on the issues that they care about. And so projects that and products that we can take to them and say, just download Signal and communicate over that, and you'll be taking a huge step toward protecting yourself and all of the people you work with, has just been an absolutely tremendous asset. My thoughts, I could also go on about this for
please do.
So let me think, you know, you mentioned some of the trends that we've seen. Obviously, you know, the last year with COVID-19 has given authoritarians a real excuse to clamp down, to increase surveillance, to increase censorship. They're doing it behind the veil of crisis and everybody kind of in panic mode. There have been a few other trends. You know, before that, we were seeing digital authoritarianism start to spread. One of the responses that we've seen to disinformation and chaos of an online information environment was controls rather than more openness, more trust, how to create healthy information environments. But what are some of the trends? I would imagine that in the GovZero community, there's a lot of people who want to get their hands dirty and start making things and doing things that can help solve problems. So what are some of the trends that you see? What do you think the ask from the sort of democracy, freedom of speech, freedom of the press community to the GovZero community and the open source movement should be in terms of what problems we need to be addressing?
I mean, I think that I'm not the one to make that decision. What I believe is that developers, and I love GovZero, we were heartbroken last year when we couldn't go back to Taiwan for the third time for the Earth Summit. But you know, we've had many, many wonderful working relationships with the GovZero community there. And, I think the most important thing is to be invested in the community that you want to serve. So you're not designing solutions to invented problems, but you are creating solutions with the people that need the solutions. And that's something that is very, very important, I think, for this work, is that the super smart people that can make technology need to be engaged with the people that need to use the technology. And I think that, you know, what we've seen over the last 8 years is that really multiplies, you know, to a huge degree the ability to have impact and positive impact in this way. So I would say one thing that we do a lot of is apply research. So constantly the various projects and fellows are doing research on new ways, new attack vectors, new ways to circumvent, and all of these things are coming up very quickly. I think that for the GovZero community, being up to date, up to speed on the things that we are learning can excite you and can really, you know, get your mind going on what kinds of things that you can do that deals with these problems and these issues. Because every one of you, every one of us knows people that are being adversely impacted by digital authoritarianism. And we just, if we can do something, we have to do something.
So, I mean, I would encourage you that to figure to stay on top of things that you care about, and I guarantee you, on every single issue that you care about, there is an internet freedom technology piece of it that deeply needs to be addressed. I mean, there's just no shortage of the need and the complexity of the solutions. And, you know, we support a diversity of solutions. We don't believe there's a one bullet that will, you know, what is that called? Silver bullet. Yeah, we don't believe in the silver bullet. We believe in throwing as many parallel solutions as possible so that the user, the beneficiary, the person that needs this tech can choose and adopt whatever they want, whatever they feel comfortable with. Because at the end of the day, this is all about the user. So if you want to work on these problems, get with people that need you. And I think that would be enormous.
Yeah, that's a sort of, I think that's true in all walks of life as well. Don't try and solve imagined problems.
Unfortunately, I feel like so much wasted energy, time, and talent goes to things that are never actually going to touch a person. And this stuff touches people, and so we have to get it right.
Yeah, absolutely. So I'm going to keep asking questions, but I want to encourage everyone in the room as well to submit questions. I'm sure that it's been explained to you, but I am actively monitoring the question and answer platform, and we're ready to field all of your questions fully. But in the meantime, I have a long list, so if you don't ask questions, it's okay, but you'll just have to listen to me and Libby talk forever about things that I decided we're going to talk about rather than things that you guys have decided that you're going to talk about. If I was actually in the room with all of you, I would start kind of intimidating you into
calling names.
Unfortunately, I'm too far away to do that, and I have to find you all here after I put you on the spot. So, Libby, we've talked a lot about what worked about OGF and what continues to work about OGF, and it's the critical role that it's played in the internet freedom community. What do you think hasn't worked? I mean, aside and not
a single point of failure problem?
Yeah.
I mean, I think that's the most massive problem we ran into, obviously. I think that when you are working in an environment, can you hear me?
Yeah, I can hear you. If you want to get into what happened here in the U.S. and what those dynamics were for folks who weren't following this day to day.
Sure, I'll give you the thumbnail version of Crisis 2020 for the Open Technology Fund. Basically, the U.S. government agency that's job it is to provide the funding that Congress wants to give OTF to OTF was taken over by a new CEO, and this person decided to gut everything, and particularly the Open Technology Fund. So since he took the job as the CEO of USAGM, he immediately fired the Open Technology Fund's board of directors. He fired me, he fired Laura Cunningham, the president, and withheld $20 million of funding that OTF had been given and approved by the U.S. Congress.
That $20 million of funding was then earmarked for internet freedom projects.
Yes, at the time, and so a few things have happened, as Amy said. OTF was created in Radio Free Asia in 2011, and at the end of 2019, we rolled it out of Radio Free Asia and created its own standalone corporation. So the Open Technology Fund was its own nonprofit corporation. And this was done with much consultation and discussion with the U.S. Congress, and to document that at the end of August, the agency for Global Media, sent a congressional notification that put in writing that they were going to provide funds so that the Open Technology Fund could roll out and become its independent corporation, because we believe that that would be the best way to serve the internet freedom goals that the legislature has. So at that time, we started a new corporation. The U.S. Congress designated $20 million for the new corporation. And unfortunately, coming out of Radio Free Asia, we have a lot of funding in the Radio Free Asia that had to be transferred to OTF. And then OTF had to get considered like portions. So if you have 12 months in a year, they would like to give you monthly payments. We ended up doing quarterly payments and we want annual payments. So what happened is once this person came in, we just stopped funding the Open Technology Fund. So not only did we lose $10 million in this past year's funding, but all the funding that was provided in prior years under the Radio Free Asia umbrella was stopped too. So the Open Technology Fund hit a massive crisis moment. And the good news is, the board stuck together and they sued Michael Pack and the agency, and the Attorney General in DC brought his own lawsuit against them for violating nonprofit laws, etc. on this, and Laura and the board of directors have been allowed to stay in place. So what happened is basically by September of this past year, OTF ran out of money and had to stop work on 80% of our actors' projects. This was not even as bad as the other part, which is for the first time since inception, OTF had to stop taking proposals. And we had to stop taking rapid response requests. And just the Open Technology Fund had to just stop doing everything that for 8 years it had been doing to earn the trust and respect of the community and of contributors, but also users. So that's what I refer to as this single point of failure problem. The way we designed OTF was to be super, super flexible. So we basically said to other funders, we have a methodology. We use subject matter experts, and this is how we do. We have an ongoing annual proposal process, so it's always open. There's not one time a year, two times a year. It's whenever a need is identified or a solution is identified, that's what we'll do. So all of this momentum, the movement of the work in this space came to a shattering halt. And what we had thought was smart, which was to not make other funders recreate the wheel on trying to do due diligence, but earning their trust and respect for the Open Technology Fund's ability to do due diligence became terrible, because then the funders didn't have the OTF to be processing all of these great ideas, to be working with the people that submit them, to help them develop their ideas, to find collaborators for their ideas, give them pointers, sometimes mentors, designers, lawyers. I mean, everything that the Open Technology Fund was created to do stopped happening. And so there are two things that really need to be emphasized, in my view, for internet freedom work. And one is always diversity of solutions, as I said before, because it's not about us, it's about what a user wants to do and what will work. And then diversity of funding. We should never be in another situation where something like this can happen and just ruin the momentum that's in, been baked into the internet freedom movement over the last 8 years.
Yeah, absolutely. Hi. I muted that person because I'm not sure that they're supposed to be fully. So we do have a question from the audience. For Libby, you mentioned OTF can respond to CSO's needs better and more quickly than traditional funding can. Can Can you provide a case study, and what are the most important reasons behind why you're more able to respond quickly?
Well, I say that in the context of what existed before, and you know, pretty much what exists up to last year, which is the way U.S. government funds were, you know, distributed in this area. So in a traditional government agency, normally there is an annual and at best twice annual solicitation of ideas. But everybody knows that's not the way technology works. It's not like the whole world just stops after one round of proposals have been vetted and awarded. I mean, it's just kind of preposterous. So, by focusing on having an open call and keeping the Open Technology Fund to 2-month windows, we're able to develop a very nimble way to do it. In fact, we invested a lot of money into the open source technology for web applications so that other funders can just use that, pick it up and use it. But what it was designed to do is make it as painless as possible for the person with the idea and for any of the experts that were going to weigh in and assess the idea. So everybody, it's a very fast system, and there's so much pressure because everybody in the organization is focused on service. So when somebody comes through the door, especially when we hear about a shutdown, there's been so many shutdowns in the last year, but if we hear about a shutdown in a certain city, immediately we are looking at what can we do there. Who do we know that can recognize us with the people on the ground there so that they know they can come to us, ask us, and we will, do everything we can in all of our networks and all of the great partners that we have around the world to help people. So the rapid response allows for event-driven crises, but the ongoing open call means that there are constantly contracts and awards being given. Proposals, due diligence, awards, always moving. And that way, I think it's much more nimble because it is dynamic to the circumstances and not just, what is convenient for accountants or bookkeepers or, people like that.
Yeah, you sort of got into this a little bit earlier, and we're pushing you on it in this context with it too. I think that our organization are principally funded by U.S. government funding. And U.S. government funding, for good reason, it's U.S. taxpayer money, and it's, to my mind, as someone who comes from a small island, tremendous amounts of funding gets directed toward democracy assistance. Not as much as should be directed toward internet freedom, but there's still relatively large sums, and we have a responsibility to administer that transparently with accountability and in a way that respects the intent of what that funding is supposed to do. Though that has then led to processes that require large institutions with lots of lawyers and people who can write grants and who can fulfill all of the reporting requirements. And it sounds like what you did with OTF was create a structure that meant for CSOs at the grassroots, you were able to navigate not around those challenges, but to adhere to the requirements for transparency and reporting and accountability without at the same time putting a whole bunch of administrative work that requires skill sets and experience onto a couple of technologists who are trying to fix a problem at the grassroots and don't have that capacity.
That's absolutely true. From day one, the Open Technology Fund was designed so that we would take the burden of the administration off them. So as a recipient of U.S. government funds and with the responsibility, as you point out, to taxpayers for accountability and efficiency and transparency, we were very focused on not wasting anybody's money. And what happened, I mean, before the Open Technology Fund existed, I would see with great alarm that, you know, some hypothetical tools would be submitting the same proposal to three different U.S. government agencies who are drawing money for the same purpose from the Congress. And that's not a good use of taxpayer money. And then some of the agencies had such enormous reporting requirements, as you point out, that these tool makers had to hire, you know, administrators and all of these giant back rooms just to feed the reporting requirements to the U.S. government. So at the Open Technology Fund, we take that load off. You know, for our projects, we let them know exactly what the milestones are going to be, and, you know, then it's an active partnership between OTF and the project. So we're constantly working together so that we can articulate what it is that you achieve. I mean, it is not your job to figure out how to do some fancy, like some beautiful presentation in the report. That's why we created the learning lab, so that would take it off. And, you know, you should have to figure out how to translate your tools into whatever language means your tools. So we created the localization lab, so that burden we can take it off. So every single point in this iterative development, we are trying to take more and more distraction or burden off of the projects and yet increase transparency.
Yeah, that's really fantastic. So another question that we've got from the audience is, does OTF have a special vision or plan for the future?
Asia is a huge priority, obviously, because China is the leading adversary in this field, the most advanced and sophisticated adversary in this field. And, you know, their influence is obviously spreading all over the world. Their technologies are not just given to other, fragile states and non-democratic countries, but, you know, training, money, all of this personnel, they're all being fed. And so in that way, China will always be the center because we have to look at the technologies that they're developing and deploying, say, they like to test out a lot of their malign technology on the Tibetan exile community. So we have done a lot of work with that community. They are the land of guinea pigs for Chinese technology, as well as the Uyghurs and other minority and disenfranchised people in China. So if we know what the Chinese are working on, then we can solve to that problem, which will later expand to the rest of the world. But, you know, there are certainly other areas that lead in certain ways. You know, the North Koreans, they have incredible technology on a controlled internet. In Iran, Russia, I mean, everybody has their own threat matrix. But we have to focus on the drivers of that technology as we're developing solutions to that technology. Because this is not a regional problem, although obviously there are regional issues everywhere, but the technology can be used not just in the country that it's developed in. So if we can solve to what the CCP is using on Hong Kong and activists, then we know what's going to come down the pipe later on in South America, Africa, and in the MENA countries, certainly in Pakistan, you know, the countries that will later be deploying these same technologies. Yeah, it's a good question.
Hi. Thank you for EB and Annie. Sorry, I have to interrupt you because we are running out of time. Is there any spreading question or otherwise? We are very thankful for Amy's and Libby's very presentations for this battle for internet.
Thank you. And thank you, Libby, for your time as well.
No, thank you. I'm so sorry that I didn't answer your question. You know, anybody can just email me if you want to find me, and I'm happy to answer any questions that you have. But I wish I were there with you. I can't begin to tell you how much I wish I were with you. So take care, everybody. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.